the conversation drifted to, you know, absolutely clear skies, not a single cloud in the sky. And then I pointed to one corner and said, except for that bit. And that's when my dad said, that's not a cloud, it's the Milky Way. But the ASM was very clear. He said, don't travel after dark to Lucknow. So better you stay there. So I said, why? He said, nothing much. There was another company's ASM was assaulted and murdered some 8 months ago. But since then, nothing has happened. 2015 end, I got this, I felt something which I had never felt ever in my life, and something which I thought that I would never venture into, which was, I decided that, you know, I'm done with working for someone else.
This is Origin Stories, a show about Indian brands, businesses, founders, and how they got here. Have you looked up at the night sky and felt the immense size of the universe? You might have. Have you ever looked up at the night sky and thought, I'm going to make money from this?
I'm Ravi Kaushik, and on today's show, we have Paul Savio of Starscapes. Starscapes builds and runs space observatories in the remotest parts of India. Paul's mission is to share his passion for science and space with school children, families, and anyone curious about their place in the universe. He does this by running Astro Tours, photography workshops, and rocket building sessions. Lakhs of Indians have attended his events. Come along as we follow Paul from his IIM Calcutta days to his stints at giants like Nokia and Samsung to his first observatory in Uttarakhand. The fascinating journey begins 3 decades back in rural Kerala, where a young Paul was visiting his grandparents.
This is just after the rains subsided, and we were in the terrace and we were looking up, and you know, again, I still remember seeing stars like I've never seen before. And the conversation drifted to, you know, absolutely clear skies, not a single cloud in the sky. And then I pointed to one corner and said, except for that bit. And that's when my dad said, that's not a cloud, it's the Milky Way. Wow. And you suddenly, you know, you get a perspective of yourself, which even at an age of 9 or 10, you can suddenly realize that you're just a speck in something which is so vast, right? Because you can see the stars, and stars are specks in the sky. But When you see the Milky Way, it is, you've seen that in textbooks, you've seen that in pictures, you see a big spiral thing which says that, you know, the sun is a small dot on this huge thing called the galaxy and all that. And suddenly you're seeing that galaxy. It puts everything into perspective, it kind of gives you a realism shot, no? And that was something which was a great experience, which still lingers today for me. That thrill is something which I shared every time I've done a stargazing experience, as either, you know, someone who's just attending a stargazing session or taking a stargazing session, that thrill and that experience was something which I could sense in the others, and we shared it, and that never dies.
And you had this great experience around age of 9 or 10, but then when you come back to Bangalore, you're back in the AIEEE, IIT rat race, right? How did you carry through your passion for astronomy, astrophotography, all of that through what for most middle-class Bangaloreans is the rat race or the academic experience?
Bangalore, of course, has a huge, pretty good astronomy scene. There are a lot of people, I mean, I'm not talking about today, I'm talking about, say, 20, 25 years ago. Today, of course, it's peaked. But it's always been the case where, to an extent, we had the planetarium, and it was always quite vibrant. There was the astronomers, the Bangalore Amateur Association of Bangalore Astronomers, which was also there. It was also, of course, there was also the, you know, the encouragement from home. So dad and mom used to encourage us experimenting in these things and going out and checking out these things and stuff like that. There was also opportunities like contests and competitions which could give that exposure.
You go from Bangalore to Suratkal, so that's an engineering degree. And as we know, most engineers don't do engineering work. You went on to write the CAT. You got through IIM Calcutta. Till there, at any point, did you think this is a possibility to be a business, or were you still in the, hey, it's something I do for 2 or 3 hours a week, I still need to like become a management consultant or a salesperson or a marketing expert? Did you have to choose between the two, or were you very clear that this was a hobby and never going to be
a business? This was definitely a hobby. If you go back to the school days, that was when I was seriously considering it as a career. I wanted to get into aerospace or astrophysics, engineering or research in the field of astronomy. But I didn't find opportunities that I would wanted to pursue. I tried to look beyond India, but that was not a thing which worked out, possibly because of lack of exploration or just lack of avenues to explore, right? I didn't really pursue it. You have a lot of avenues today which weren't there 20 years ago.
So take me through your time at IIM Calcutta. So I know that you wanted to get through IIT and you didn't after 12th standard. And that's the dream of most people that were like us at that point in time in Bangalore, right?
Yeah.
But you cracked CAT, which is point. I'm sure you were top 0.5% of India at that point in time.
It's a nice thing to say, right? But yeah, I mean, it's a toss-up at the end of the day. I think the top 5% in the country are a toss-up. But I got lucky, obviously. And it all worked out. I joined IIM Calcutta. The thing is, what matters a lot in, especially as you go up to these levels, is the peer group. It's just selection bias. You have ultra-smart people who are, today, I mean, 10 years down the line, I can say, they are, many of them are CEOs, many of them are running their own companies. And you know how uber successful these people are. And they were smart in school also. And it was great to interact with such people. And that was the part I loved about those 2 years, right? It worked out eventually for pretty much almost all of us. And we were that batch of people when I think we were sitting for our summer placements, which in the banking sector, because it's a finance leaning school, right? A lot of people look at getting into the Lehman Brothers and the Goldman Sachs of the world. And November was our placements, September 18th, Lehman declared bankruptcy.
This is 2008.
2008. And we were that batch. So wow. We had a bunch of people sitting for placements, all like really smart people who possibly would have had a very, very different career if they were, you know, 5 years earlier. Trying to get into a field which did not exist because you suddenly had banks collapsing left, right and center and they became extremely undesirable. But in 2 years' time, the market turned again. And again, we were the beneficiaries of the turn. So by the time we graduated college, the market was on the upswing. But I got into Hindustan Lever at that time. And very soon, you know, over those next 1.5 years, I kind of realized that that's what I wanted to do. Because
you got through Hindustan Lever in the first year?
For my internship.
For internship, yeah. Okay.
You know, along with that internship, plus, you know, the education which happened afterwards, I realized that, you know, what excited me was creating that value perception through marketing. And, you know, you're actually showcasing what value you have. And then seeing the realization of that through sales.
And Hindustan Unilever is an extremely prestigious brand at the IIMs from a marketing.
Yeah, it was for marketing. It was the most sought after brand at the time. I think it still is. I'm not too sure how that's changed. But it is, I mean, it is the biggest FMCG in the country and one of the biggest in the world, right? So it is extremely sought after. Of course, now today, I don't know whether the Amazons of the world have taken that space. But yeah, I limited myself to the marketing companies and I managed to score Nokia at that time. And incidentally, Nokia was the most sought after company that year, in at least along with HUL and P&G.
This is at the peak of
2010,
Nokia.
Yes. And the peak very rapidly fell because the placement was in May. And by June, people were asking, why are you joining Nokia?
Wow.
So again, I got to see the fall of one of the world's most prestigious brands from within. So Nokia takes you in for a national role. And the office is in Gurgaon.
Okay.
But we get to do 1 year of training. 6 months I spent in a small town called Hardoi, which is around 100 kilometers north of Lucknow. And the territory I handled were from Hardoi onwards all the way up to the Nepal border, 3 districts of UP.
And you know zero Hindi, right?
I know zero Hindi at this moment. And this is entirely rural, right? So the average price at that time for a handset, which the country used to sell, was around 3,500 rupees or 4,000 rupees. And my average price was around 1,200 rupees because it was as rural as it could get. And the ASM was very clear. He said, don't travel after dark to Lucknow. So better you stay there. So I said, why? He said, nothing much. There was another company's ASM was assaulted and murdered some 8 months ago. But since then, nothing has happened. So I don't think you should worry about it. But just don't, you know, just be safe. I was like, okay, I think that's not something I'm used to. Anyway, so I decided to stay in a small town, which is a big deal for the small town also. So even my distributors never hosted a sales manager. And Nokia was, for the last 10 years, was the thing which made their lives, right? It kind of built them from ground up to the millionaires they were at that moment.
So on your first day, you have a meeting with all the dealers and obviously they'll speak in Hindi. How did you communicate?
In fact, I remember the first meeting with the sales team. And these were the some of the best guys in the district or in the state, actually. One of them who's won awards and all that. So I was talking to him and basically we started discussing. And then I asked him, I wanted to check what the performance of the top selling model at the time. It was a phone called Nokia 2690. It was a 2000 rupee phone or something. And it was hot selling product across the country. So I asked him, that's usually your benchmark. You know, how's the sales going? So I asked him, 2690 ka sales kaisa hai. Do, che, no, shunya. And he had a blank look on his face and he looked at the distributor. Then the distributor looked at him and said, nahi, wo pooch rahe hai ki 2690 ka sale kaisa hai. That's when I realized, we say 2690, in Hindi they say 2690, so it is 2690. And I knew numbers from 1 to 20. I didn't know anything beyond that. At that moment, I still remember taking my phone with its 3G, newly, you know, rolled out 3G connection and sitting over there and opening a website which showed numbers from 1 to 100 and sitting and mugging up the numbers from 1 to 100 in the next 1 hour.
Wow.
Because that was it. That was the language you had to learn. And it really felt like you were in the deep end of the pool with, you know, with a lifebuoy around you. Because there was a support system, but you had to learn to swim. And I had a town which was right at the Nepal border. I used to go there and you could see the border checkpost and stuff like that. So it was quite an interesting experience for those 6 months. Kind of set me up for the next two stints I had with Nokia. The next one was in Andhra for another 6 months and then Punjab for another 6 months. So it was all over the, you know, three different cultural centers which I got to see in my first job itself. So it was a good experience there. I saw another part of India and border town. So I did my trips to, you know, Amritsar and saw Jallianwala Bagh and Wagah border and all that. So it was fun while it lasted.
What was the collapse of Nokia from the inside like? Because it's easy to forget now, but at that time Nokia was probably larger than what even Apple is today, right? They were in probably every country in the world except North Korea.
So what happened in Nokia was, one, they stagnated internally. There was no innovation happening. They also kind of got too big, basically, as a company. It became a behemoth and it wasn't really moving. Innovation is stifled. Two is, on the handset side, Samsung got in. So as devices, they started assaulting Nokia brutally. So, you know, basically go to retailers and Nokia gives 2% margin, Samsung gives 10% margin, right? And Samsung starts paying for visibility and stuff like that and poaching distributors and retailers completely. And on the software side, on the premium side, you had Apple getting into the picture. So all these things happened at the same time. Nokia stagnated, plus Apple and Samsung and Android hit at the same time. So within that span of 3 years, the consumer just shifted base. And I switched to Samsung in 2013.
Correct.
And yeah.
How long were you at Samsung?
Samsung was, again, 2 years. But Samsung was interesting because I worked in a European company and then an Indian company and now in a Korean company. So an East Asian company, it's a completely different paradigm. They're very clear about what they want. And they're very clear that if you don't deliver, you leave. Wow. And they have very clear set rules. You stay within the rules and you perform, you go up, you stay within the rules and you kind of manage your way, you can stay on. You break the rules, whether you're performing or not, you leave. And we created a program which is alive even now as one of the most significant retail loyalty programs for the mobile industry.
Could you expand what that means?
Essentially what we did was we said, if you're my top retailer, I can give you more money. But then anyone else can come and give more money to, more than what I give you, right? So if I'm giving you 5% margin on my phone, someone can come and give you 10% margin.
When you say retailer, it's the final shop on the road.
The shop. The shop who where you go and buy.
Consumer goes and purchase.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is the offline market for Samsung, where Samsung, through its distributors, sells to the retailers. And these are the individual retailers I'm talking about, not the big chains, not your Chromas and your, what do you have? Sangeetas and Purvikas, not those guys. It is your individual retailers. And there are quite a few of them because the big guys used to do an average of around 70, 80 lakhs of revenue for Samsung alone per outlet, per month.
Wow.
And Samsung used to be third. So if you're talking about 80 lakhs, you're saying on an average, they would do 2.5 crores of revenue. So if you're talking about 2.5 crores of revenue, and even if they take back, say, 5% of that, 12.5 lakhs of profit every month, which these outlets book, right? And I don't think you have too many MSMEs which do that today. And they also sell all brands. So the idea was get the loyalty of these brands to push your brand, because they have a spin-off effect to the rest of the market. If the top shops start talking about OnePlus, then people will start looking at that, say, okay, great. So this guy is selling OnePlus. Maybe I should buy a OnePlus and then go possibly to a smaller store or in a small town and, you know, buy that brand. So that network effect of brands is very important for these outlets, which is why companies spend a huge amount. So if you go into any of these big outlets, you'll see huge kiosks inside the store. You'll have boards, you'll have demo devices which you can go and play around with. All these are company sponsored. And companies spend a lot on these outlets simply because of that. So what we thought was, instead of giving that for the outlet, there's a business aspect which we're anyway doing. Let that be the hygiene factor. What more can we do? So that's when we started talking about how to engage with the retailer on his personal life. So we started giving them benefits which they could use when they go out on a holiday. We gave them a concierge service. We gave them special benefits for, you know, shopping vouchers and stuff, which their or spa vouchers, which their family with their wives or sons or daughters could use. We gave scholarships for the kids. I'll give you one example. Was in, I think, Hubli or Belgaum or one of these places where all the business happens on the main streets, and they decided to dig up the road. So all those outlets had to shut down for like 6 months.
Wow.
And in those 6 months, the threshold for invitation was historically you do around 50 lakhs of business or something like per month. And these guys dropped to something like 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs. And we invited them back into the program, saying that we know why you had this problem. That moment when they got invited, it was a huge spark of loyalty for them. And they kind of swore by Samsung after that. Wonderful. And we gave them a lot of family time. So we used to actually have a monthly dinner for the dealers. So they could take their family, their wife and their children out for a dinner. And we used to send a Merc or a BMW to their house.
And this is in non-metro India.
It will be in small towns and stuff like that. Wherever we could, if it wasn't a Merc or thing, we used to get the most posh vehicle for that town.
It matters that the neighbors see them.
Yes. There'll be one guy who goes there, he'll give a bouquet to them, invite them into the car, and the car will go to the best hotel, it's a 5-star hotel, a 7-star, whatever, go there. And there'll be a separate table set out for them, menu will be given to them, and then there'll be a photo op at the end of it, which will be printed out and given to them and stuff like that. So those kind of experiences came in, right? Holidays and stuff like that. And the other thing was every company was giving holidays for the dealers.
Yeah.
What we said was we'll give you lounge access. So even if you're going, say, a Samsung or whatever, a Micromax or whatever, some other brand which gives you a trip, you go on a Micromax trip, but you access the lounge because of Samsung. So you stand out even from everyone else because you're a Samsung loyal dealer. So those kind of differentiations we started creating. And it is a very exciting phase for me because I started understanding something which all of us intuitively know, how to get people, how to make people feel good.
Yeah.
That is a good experience which went on till around 2015. By 2015 end, I felt something which I had never felt ever in my life and something which I thought that I would never venture into, which was I decided that, you know, I'm done with working for someone else.
Were you tired of bureaucracy or were you disappointed by this is just money? Or did you have like a quarter life crisis or was it more like, I just want to do something under my own banner?
I think it was a lot of the first point, the tired of bureaucracy thing. It was, I mean, it's not the red tapeism alone. It's about the fact that there are a lot of vested interests which you have to play around with, which could actually hinder everything you want to do. Even in an extremely process-oriented company like Samsung, that used to happen. It's like you're having a motor race and the drivers have to basically think of removing the trees from the road being the main challenge rather than actually driving towards the finish line. That was the feeling I had. So I thought, let's try out and see if we can, you know, make it big on your own. Whole other battle. The idea there was, this is something like a go-to-market consultancy. Essentially what it means is, I know the market in India for this particular segment of the industry, let's say electronics. You are an electronics brand sitting in China or US or Europe or Somalia or wherever.
Hmm.
You want to get into India. Now, if you have to enter India, what you need to do is first of all, come here and understand the market.
Yeah.
Right? And then bring your product or adapt your product to the Indian market. Then set up a sales channel, marketing, all that support and stuff like that. What we said was, we will do the second part. We will do the market understanding. You just bring your product.
Okay.
Bring your product and obviously put in the money. But the business will help you set up here because we know the market. And that was the crux of what a GTM consultancy was. We started working with a couple of brands with a couple of exercises which went off pretty well. And then there's one company which was in the field of mobile accessories. So basically phone covers and chargers and cables and power banks and so on. And they said they wanted to start off in India. And we helped them start it by getting some distributors on board. And for 6 months that business went on. So basically there was sales, there was everything which was happening. And then after that, they came and said, why don't you just setting it up and handing it over to us? Why don't you run the business here?
When you say accessories, like what are included? And
yeah, so your phone covers, your chargers, your cables, your okay. power banks. So we took a huge space around 20,000 square feet in Gurgaon, factory space, put up the assembly line, 6 assembly lines and all that. Brands which were China-based, they were sending the raw material. We were assembling it here and we decided to build the business up here. That was my next 3 years of life in the industry.
You ran this business for 3 years on behalf of a different brand, but you were like the local CEO.
Yeah, so operations basically. So we the brand was still a brand which was established because it was selling earlier in India. And yeah, so it was their brand which we were licensed to own. It was not that we were a manufacturing facility for that brand. It was more like we had taken the license for that. And the P&L was ours.
Understood.
So we used to invest it. It was not like they were paying our salaries or anything.
Got it.
So it was.
Taking the market risk and the.
Yeah. Everything was us. So we used to actually buy the products from them. So their involvement got over the moment we paid for the raw material.
How did your first stint into the entrepreneurial world as compared to your corporate world at the end of 3 years?
It actually, it got hit really bad during COVID. Till 2019, we had our ups and downs, both in terms of, the market changing, moving away from mobile manufacturing of power banks and so on. And one of the things which happened was people stopped moving around, right? So people stopped requiring power banks. So when no one requires power banks, there's nothing for us to sell. Because our business was pretty much manufacturing was power banks and chargers, and power banks was around 90% of our revenue. Kids will never understand how crazy it was. Just that, I'm not talking about those 2 years. I'm talking about that 1 month after the lockdown was announced, and that craze of, even people who are extremely privileged like us, we are so used to ordering stuff home and then ordering wasn't happening.
Yeah.
And as you go down, it becomes so exponentially more complex and heart-wrenching as you go down the social pyramid, right? And it affected us in a lot of ways because we were still financially managing well off and stuff like that. We are wealthy enough to tide through these things. A lot of our employees weren't. And especially in the factory, a lot of the labor wasn't. So it was extremely painful to let some people go. But the bulk of the team we kept on. And we continued paying salaries for as long as we could. Some of them, especially the labor, was usually from UP and Bihar. So they had to go back home. We worked with Flipkart in developing some audio range and all that. Because that's when your wireless started picking up, your true wireless earbuds and stuff like that. So a lot of products, we launched, I think, six products, I think, across Flipkart's portfolio, including their own brand, HRX and all that. But it didn't last.
And when you had to shut this business down, did you take a break before you started Starscapes? Or was it like
no,
a seamless?
No, actually, so Starscapes happened, it overlapped this in a very, very significant way. So we were sitting over there and then Ramesh was talking about astronomy. That's when I found out that he was also an amateur astronomer. And he had a cottage in this place called Kausani in Uttarakhand. It's a small town, gets around 2 lakh tourists. It's got, 10,000 people or something who live in that place.
Is it like a religious place or is it hill station?
It has a combination of both. So there is a small temple and a lot of the trekking community comes past that place because there are a lot of treks around that.
Okay.
So they do a pit stop there essentially. And there's an ashram there. It's a small town, but 2 lakh is a very small number actually if you think about it. So
this is his personal cottage, like
yes.
For him to
retreat. Basically like a summer house kind of thing.
Okay.
So there he had a telescope. And that house, when he was not there, he used to let it out on Airbnb and so on. And guests who used to come there used to love seeing through the telescope. What Ram thought was, why don't we just open this up? So he got a small rooftop on one of his restaurants and got it built up. Basically put 4 walls and a roof which could move and mounted the telescope there. Started ticketing those experiences. We trained some local people to handle the telescope and taught them about the night sky and stuff like that. And they used to conduct the shows. So essentially it became like a show. So basically what happens is you go in, you get your ticket, you go into that place. It's like a 4 walls and a roof, right? With a dimly lit place and there's the telescope in the middle.
Yes.
And then suddenly the roof opens up and all you see above you is the night sky.
I'm a trekker in Uttarakhand. How will I find out about this?
That's local discovery. So we just got the local tours and travel, the taxi drivers, the auto guys, the hotels nearby. We just told them that this thing is there. During that experience, essentially, there is one person who is an expert, who we call the star guide, who explains the night sky. So he teaches you, he talks to you about the stars and constellations and planets and how to identify them, what they signify, what's the stories behind them, history, mythology, science, everything. It's like a whole story narrative which is built up. Like a half an hour chat which happens, and that's the bulk of it. And then afterwards, you get to see a lot of the objects through the telescope, whether it's the moon, the craters on the moon, or the rings of Saturn, or the satellites of Jupiter, and some deep space objects like some galaxies and star clusters, nebulas, and all that stuff.
And at what time or at what point did you realize that, okay, this can be more than a passion project?
So one is it kept growing. So just for an illustration, we had priced the ticket at 100 rupees or something, 50 rupees or something the first year. And we brought it up to 100 rupees, 150 rupees the next year. The customer base kept growing. We brought it up to 350 the next year. It kept growing. We brought it up to 500 rupees the following year, and it still kept growing. It's around 2019 where I said, I'm tired of this, so I don't really want to continue with this mobile accessories. Of course, I did continue for another 2 years because that COVID happened, and then we had to keep that thing alive or help to wind it down and stuff like that. Because the concept was simple. Concept was, open up in a place where people visit. So we don't have to drive traffic there. It just has to be discoverable. And it has a fairly decent night sky. So you give a night sky experience, but for people who have never had a night sky experience.
Got it.
So your baseline is low. We went, we identified a partner who would help us set up in Nainital. We identified the location. Commercials were drawn out. We had to sign the agreement and COVID struck.
Wow.
So this was in the March of 2020. And our big season is the summer. Summer of 2020 went out of the picture. We had a team which was set up and we had no business. 2021 summer also went in with the Delta wave at that time. So we didn't have any business for 2 years. So
how did you keep your team engaged for that time?
It was very difficult. So we tried a lot of things. A lot of them went back home and then they came back. At the location, they tried a lot of variations, you know, like some of them are engineers. So they rigged up a system where with the Wi-Fi, we didn't even have Wi-Fi. We used a mobile dongle thing. And from there, you know, through the telescope, connect a camera and then rig that and put it on the internet. So do something else.
And at what time did the traffic to these locations begin to recover? And just and why Nainital? Why not any other part of it?
Comfort zone, because it was just we didn't want to stretch ourselves too thin. We were already there in Kausani, and the thing is, even I was there in Delhi at that time.
Okay.
So with COVID striking, I moved south, and then we started exploring opportunities in the south. So 2021, immediately after the Delta wave, is when, to answer your question, when the traffic started recovering. The problem with our calendar was we have an April, May, June, and then we have a July, August, September where it shut down because of monsoons. So July, August, September of 2020 and 2021 were when the revenge tourism peaked. But the problem was those are times when we were shut down. Finally, in October of 2021, we opened our second observatory. That time, we incorporated the company Starscapes and we structured it with the objective of creating astronomy experiences and making them accessible to everyone. The core of that whole thing was astronomy experiences for everyone, right? So it's not that what we are doing is very, very different from, I mean, it's not a groundbreaking new thing which we're bringing into the world, right? Stargazing is one of the oldest things which have been there. Like Neanderthals have been looking up and doing stargazing. So it's nothing which is new. What is new is the accessibility. So what do you need for stargazing? You need clear skies. Now, where do you get clear skies? Obviously, at inaccessible places. So the clearer the sky, the more inaccessible places. I mean, it's directly proportional. So your best stargazing, you go to Google today and see what are the best stargazing sites. You'll get Ladakh, you'll get Andaman, you'll get Spiti. It's easy to say that. It's very difficult to get to any of these places. So what we said was we'll tie up with some, you know, some local resort or something where we could start the operations. And so we started talking to Club Mahindra and Madikeri in Coorg. And they said, okay, let's try it out now. So my staff set up an observatory experience within Club Mahindra's property.
Wonderful.
In Madikeri. And it was a great experience. Went off very well. So well, in fact, that Club Mahindra said, why don't we tie up nationally?
Wow. In all their centers.
Yeah. So on that 1 month sample, so we tied for all their centers. Essentially, they have 38 centers. It wasn't viable in places where it is too many, you know, too small. So we said we will look at the big centers. And 5 of the big centers, we opened up our setup.
So you had... You started Starscapes practically in the middle of the pandemic. It began to go well. You had your Delta wave. And then now you just try 1 month with Club Mahindra and then they want you to scale across their entire portfolio.
And the story didn't, the hiccups didn't end there because end of December is when they said, let's scale up. And January, February was the Omicron, the third wave. So we had another 2 month pause. Thankfully, by March, it cleared up and we opened up at Pondicherry, at Munnar, Goa, Varka Beach, and one more location in Coorg, which is at Virajpet. It's around 30 kilometers from Madikeri.
So if I'm at Club Mahindra, Goa, I am at the beach till like 5 p.m., 6 p.m., 7 p.m. I go back. I'm practically thinking, two options are Netflix, TV shows. I can't enter the swimming pool. I can't enter the beach after a particular time, or Starscapes, right? What makes a family or a couple or a guest at that location consider Starscapes?
No, so actually the first thing is that, right? I mean, the option of sitting in the room is not what people come to these resorts for. Because like I said, that go back to that that metric of accessibility and this one, right? When people come to these places, what they want to do is they want to have new experiences. It's not a great tech experience they're coming for. It's a nature experience they're coming for, which is why they go to the beach, right? Because people want to be outside. And that's something we kind of tap into, which is why your Netflix may not be the competition. What could be the competition is sitting at the restaurant and, you know, having a meal. That could be the bigger competition. And what we did was we started stacking a lot of experiences during the daytime.
Okay.
So we don't restrict our experiences to stargazing. of course, stargazing happens, which is the most, the coolest thing to do. But there is a star during the daytime. So we do have solar observations during the day. So on the telescope, we fit the solar filters, and you can observe the sun through the telescope. You'll see sunspots and stuff like that. Wow. In fact, now we have new tools with which you can observe prominences. You can observe flares and, you know, the actual structure of the sun and stuff like that from the outside.
Who's the target customer in this? Is it a family? Is it a family who's not interested in science, but they want the kids to be interested in science? Who typically is the user of
that? Yeah, so actually it's a combination of both. See, ultimately what happens is a lot of people relate to this because of many reasons. One is, when I was a kid, I had gone, like me personally, right? I had gone to my grandparents' place in a village, small town, and I saw the skies. And I've never seen that since I moved to a metro. So now I want my children to see that. So I am one of the targets for this. So I'll push my kids in there. Or I might actually want to go and see something which I had enjoyed when I was a kid. So both these are huge. And the third is kids who want to generally do activities. So while we do the solar observation and the night sky observation, we also have workshops and activities for children, like making your own rockets, making spectroscopes, sundials, pinhole projectors and stuff like that. So we take simple stuff like, take a kg cardboard, roll it up, put a cone and put the fins and connect it to a pipe, and then connect the pipe to a bottle, jump on the bottle, the rocket goes up, right? So that's a rocket workshop. While you're doing that, while you're having fun doing that, you're also learning about how the fins affect the flight, the trajectory, how the nose cone is important and stuff like that. And those kind of activities kind of get stacked up during the day. The second thing is we are working very closely with the government of Uttarakhand right now. The government wants to promote astrotourism, and they've identified certain districts and certain sites where the sky is great and there's no other tourism reason. Yeah. So for instance, Haridwar is, you don't need to promote tourism in Haridwar, right? That's done. It's been done for the last 3,000 years. You need to look at tourism somewhere else. Nainital also has its latent tourist base, but a lot of districts have nothing. And when there's no economic tent pole, you need to find one. And astrotourism would work in certain places, especially arid districts or towns, villages, where you can't grow anything, you can't do anything else. You find a reason to promote tourism.
Got it. You mentioned that there's Coorg, there's Madikeri, there is Goa and a couple of places, right? But I would assume a Madikeri and Goa compared to an Nainital or a Ladakh would be just polluted with light, right?
To an extent, you're right in about Goa. But again, that the places we are looking at is South Goa, which is also within resorts, right? So it could, to a certain extent, have that clear sky. There's a metric. It's called the bottle scale, BORTLE. It's essentially a scale of brightness. So your 9 is your basically your Indranagar. And 1 would be in the middle of the ocean or something like that. So we look at around 4 or 5. Anything lesser than 4 or 5 is still okay. So Goa would fall around 4.5, 5.
Oh, not bad.
Nainital would be around, surprisingly, would be around 3.5, 4. Kausani is 2. Madikeri is the odd one out. It's 2. It is surprisingly dark for a district headquarters. The reason is because it's forested and it's filled with coffee estates. So it's a very, very dark sky. Surprisingly dark for something which is so, critically populated.
When you start at a center like Madikeri, how do you acquire like your first customer, your first show?
Basically, we get hotels nearby aware of the fact that there is something here. We get the taxi operators, the tours and travel agents nearby who do that. And we do a bit of branding online.
So this is a referral. So when somebody asks at the railway station or the airport, what else is there to do in the city? They refer you.
Yeah, and that's a huge driver, actually. We don't understand that ecosystem because we are not part of it. But when we do get into that, ultimately, a hotel, not a resort, like say a Club Mahindra or a Taj or anything, which wants to keep its guests within it. But a hotel where people just come to stay, right? Their first thing is when they go to the reception desk and say, what is there to see here? The person there needs to give an answer which is going to be useful for the guest.
Do you have the ability to get somebody in Bangalore sitting to now visit Coorg just for you?
That's going to be the next thing, because Madikeri, our own center, is just starting. I think October is going to be the first time we're going to do that. But we haven't focused on getting people from metro, from Delhi to Nainital or Mukteshwar. Bangalore to Madikeri is going to be the first attempt we're going to do it. Because one is, we've generated enough content and enough interest by talking about our three platforms there. And two is, since all the big resorts of Club Mahindra, and we also have a tie-up with St. Regis in Goa, So we do have some level of salience here. We have not invested in that in terms of building the brand, but that's the next big push which we'll do. And we think that we'll be fairly successful moving people from Bangalore to Madikeri because of the accessibility.
From the boy who saw the Milky Way at rural Kerala to cracking the cat to joining Nokia, which eventually imploded, to then starting your first company, which may or may not have worked out the way you wanted. How did you expect this journey to be and how has it actually turned out?
Well, a lot of it was take as you go. So it was decisions, not accidents. They were all decisions, but decisions were made in a short time span, right? It was when I was growing up, it was, okay, should get into the field of astronomy professionally. That didn't happen. Got into engineering. Okay, then let's become an engineer. Let's get into signal processing and figure out something in electronics. That didn't happen. And then realized that consciously decided to move from there to management. Got into management, wanted to make it big in corporate. Then consciously decided that that's not my cup of tea. Moved to startup. Then did something which I was comfortable in, which was mobile accessories. Decided that it's not exciting enough. Consciously moved to something else. Now, I don't know what the next step will be, but it will again be a thought out decision, but it may not be something which I can predict today. I can't say 5 years from now it's going to be.
How many centers does Starscapes have today? How many projects, how many employees, and how many families do you touch in a year or customers? And where do you see that maybe like even 2 to 3 years down the line?
We have three observatories and two smaller setups. Madikeri will come up as the fourth big observatory. We have it in Kausani, Bhimtal and Mukteshwar. Those are the three ones. Madikeri will be the fourth. Uti is currently, we are revamping it, so I'm not counting it here. Apart from that, we have a partner observatories and six centers, which we will hopefully be growing to another, seven, eight more over the next 3-4 months. Spreading it out in Madikeri a little more. Uti should start soon. Coastal Tamil Nadu towards Pondicherry and up to Mahabalipuram, there are a couple of partners we are discussing with. And an exciting thing right now is to open up in Andaman, Port Blair. So there's a partner who's talking to us, who's potentially trying to partner with us. A few more business models which we're exploring is essentially to have a training program for people in small towns and villages to learn about astronomy so that they can go back and open their own center. So if I'm having a small homestay in some small village, I get 5-6 tourists every month or something like that, right?
This is a particularly tough time for anybody who is interested in science, right? There's a lot of fake news, there's a lot of controversy around vaccines or alternate forms of medicine, etc. Is that a factor for you to pursue this this project?
It is, yes. And I think the only way you can, I can give you a lot of information and you will never be able to judge for yourself whether the information is right or wrong, right? But once you experience it, it becomes personal. And that is the core of Starscapes, because we want to give you that experience. Once you experience science, we do have people who come and they observe Saturn, for instance. People refuse to observe Saturn. And some people, when they observe the sun or something, they'll remove their slippers and then observe the sun. But that's fine. But the point is, at the end of the day, you're learning that it's not reducing what our ancients taught about these things, right? They call them gods. For all practical purposes, those are awesome things. Your sun is not a small disk in the sky. It is something which is so colossal, and it is the reason for the existence of the earth. So these are things you'll actually understand. You'll understand the science behind the beliefs which you had. So we don't want to counter those beliefs. We want to kind of build on top of them. We'll never say you're stupid for believing, because that's wrong.
Awesome. It has been wonderful having you here, Paul. And thank you so much for sharing your struggles and your journey with which led you to Starscapes. Yeah.
Thanks, Ravi. It was a pleasure talking.
Thank you.